We've reached possibly the most exciting part of the painting process, and this is where we get to actually work on our real painting. Thanks for seeing all the steps through to the end, and now we really get to make the magic happen. And you're gonna find that if you went through each phase, that things are going to unfold before your eyes with a lot more ease than you've possibly experienced in the past. So let's get started. Now, I tried to keep things simple for this lesson, and you'll notice that I only have my grays and my teacup colors. This is for the outside of the teacup, and this is for the inside of the teacup. And naturally, I've got all my neutral grays here. Normally, I would keep a full spectrum of colors along the top, and eventually, I will have to add some more colors here as I see little nuances within the colors. But for now, I'm going to try to keep things very, very simple. If I need a step in between, I can just mix right on the spot, just like that. This is one of these things, you want the paint solid, but you don't want edges either. So you want it as heavy, you want it heavy enough to go on as one covering layer, but you want to keep the edges down, at least while you're learning to paint. As you gain experience, you can start to get into impasto layers and build up the paint here and there. But I would say by and large, try to keep the painting surface relatively flat and brush stroke free, meaning don't have built up edges, because if you want to fix something at a later date, it's really difficult and frustrating to paint over bumps and ridges. Another reason I like working this way, I mean, there's just so many. I'm working within a color family, and so I don't have to really clean my brush much. I am wiping it when I move around, but as you go up and down the chain here, this value string, you don't have to really clean your brush much. Just a little wipe and you're good to go. Now, objects are usually most chromatic when they face the light. Don't forget, things can seem a little bit off whenever you first start. So watch what I do here with this handle. It needs to go darker, 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 darkest right up around here. So what I'm going to do is walk those values right into place. Put the next darker one here. Next darker one there. Next darker one there. And one last dark right up there. So you see how I work the values up like that. Now this handle is so round and so smooth and blended, but I'm going to really try to resist blending. Needs to get a little bit lighter on the outside edge. The top here. In fact, some of those really extreme highlights, specular highlights, a lot of times I don't paint those at all. I get the whole thing painted, looking really decent. Then I blend where I need to. And then I'll add those little highlights on top. Sometimes I even wait until the surface dries and I'll put them on a dry painted surface because I figure it's a little less risky. I'm painting it's like a half tone in between there. Edge. Just cleaning up that edge a little bit. I think it's important to note if you've got your transfer lines, make sure you're covering them up. And then the gradation seems to be a little more graceful. So it looks like I'm going to need a half step in between these two. I don't want to run into my lightest value all the way here and then have nothing left to give. I mean, you can run out of value if you go too light too soon. That value just right on this edge. I'm really pushing the limit with this flat brush here. But I haven't ruined anything yet, so try to paint with the biggest brush I can get away with, but there's that fine line of, well, we don't want to ruin things either. This is that color that we measured earlier. This is that really light endpoint right there. To be a little bit of a highlight here. Not much. I added my paint string for the background colors because I want to work on the spoon, and the spoon has some of the background reflected in it. I also added a few earth colors up here just in case I needed to use them. I noticed there's some of this showing up in the reflection. So just a reminder, you can always take measurements. I know we already did the color study, but there's nothing wrong with taking measurements with chips, with paint swatches, looking through the aperture cards in trying to pin down colors in the painting. Because now that we're working on the actual painting and it's larger and there's more details, sometimes you have to stop and you have to remeasure things, and that's just the way it is. So while I did put some colors up here, I'm not just gonna go crazy and start throwing paint into this and throwing paint into that and getting too far away from the original plan. So I do want to keep my feet grounded here, but at the same time, you have to look for things and you have to work on the details of the painting. Sometimes you can't see it all and right from the beginning. Notice that background does reflect. It's a little less chromatic though. Sometimes what I do is I work off the sides of the piles. So this color, I can have the same hue and the same value, just a little less chroma right over here. Try to stay as organized as possible. Sometimes it's difficult, but so some of these little tiny pieces, it would be nearly impossible to measure these out. So this is where you would just try to go by relationships. How much lighter is something than something else? Of course you can look through the apertures, but some of this stuff is so small it's really hard to tell. I like to squint down on the subject matter. I squint and blur my vision. That usually gives me some guidance as to what the lightest lights are, what the darkest darks are. I mean, there are some painters, that's all most painters do is paint by relationships. I find it to be unreliable. There's too many optical illusions, and trying to teach beginners to paint, it just takes too long. The great thing about painting like this is you have a system. There's a structured set of procedures that you go through to make a painting, and I would have killed to have something like this when I started out. A series of logical steps. But no one was teaching it. So here I am teaching it to you. Thanks for sticking around. So I've got the cup largely painted and the top of the spoon painted. I'm going to give myself permission to go ahead and do a little bit of blending. I'm going to soften some of the edges, and I just have to be careful about walking the brush over. So I want to walk it over, make sure that I wipe whenever I am changing colors or changing anything that's might be a drastic change. Now what I want to work on is the background. I want to work on this backdrop. And one of the reasons is I like to lean when I paint. I do not have a steady hand, so this becomes almost like a chess game. I'm planning my moves ahead. If I were to paint this, then I'd have nowhere to lean. And yeah, I have a mall stick and I've used them, but you know what? They're kind of a pain in the neck and they're high risk. I slip. And why bother? I could just plan my move. So I'm going to paint this background and then I'll work my way down. So this is the kind of thing where I want to take some measurements. Definitely lighter over here, and it gets darker over here. So this is one of those areas where the handle, the inside of the handle, now that I've got it painted, I can see the relationship and I can see that this inside shadow needs to get much darker, because when I squint my eyes, this shadow disappears into that background. And then right now I have this really light silhouette there. So this has to get darker, and I have to soften the edge between them. There's a very slight value change here. This is, once again, we're having a series of grays is very helpful. Spend more time looking and painting and less time mixing. It's where I think pre-mixing actually makes the painting process faster. It seems like more work, but it actually makes this painting time go a lot quicker. Now this is the tablecloth reflecting into this creamer here, this little creamer jug pitcher thingy. And since I've already got the tablecloth mixed, even though I didn't paint it yet, we know the reflection is going to be born out of this paint string over here. So we can use logic to paint it. It's not going to be a drastic change. And I did take some measurements with my aperture cards and my Munzel book. So, and it is. This is, it ended up right around this color right here. And as you recall, that was one of the colors that I pre-mixed. A couple sections get a little bit darker, so that's where I can dip into the one of these darker grays. lighter here, but the chroma also drops. I think one of the biggest mistakes a lot of students make when they're paint mixing is they just simply add white to everything to lighten it. Sometimes when things lighten up, the chroma drops. Sometimes there's hue shifts. You gotta pay attention to this stuff. Just pure white is not always the answer. Now this needs to get darker. When I squint down, there's way too much contrast here. So how will I solve that problem? I'll first start by wiping my brush, making sure that that's nice and clean. Then I'll go back to this color. I need a little bit darker variety. If this was a larger area of the painting, I would stop what I'm doing, mix up a batch, and I would check it on a piece of paper or against a Munzel chip. But in the interest of getting through this and in a timely manner, I'm just gonna mix it darker. So it's probably a little bit hard to tell in the video, but there's distinct separations. Thin metals like this can be really difficult. You have to pay attention to the edges. So on the inside here, the value here, which is so small you could never really measure it. But when I squint, it just about disappears into the background. So that gives me a pretty good idea of the value, because I know the value of this and I've painted this, so then I can get a value that's very close. So you can do it comparatively. It's really hard when you're starting out on these metals. It's difficult, but if you just keep making a lot of observations and go really slowly, it'll start to come together. And I've been saying this numerous times throughout this video series, but really it comes down to patience, planning, and close observation, really. A lot of times when you're painting metals, there's little points where it's darker, but there's actually reflections that are a little bit higher in chroma than you would anticipate. And that can make the objects really look shiny and have some excitement to the paintings. So don't think that it's all just neutral gray. It's not. Have to find a little bit of variety. You can start off with a base of neutrals and then look for a couple of those little exciting colored spots where the chroma kicks up just a little bit. Now that I've got all the major sections painted in this object, I'm going to allow myself to do a small amount of blending. What this means is I'm softening some of the edges, and where I had separate bands of color, I am softening the edges between them so that I can have smoother gradations. I have to be careful not to overdo it. When you do this kind of work, make sure you continually wipe the brush, or you'll be picking paint up and putting it where it doesn't belong. And not everything deserves to be as soft, so you do have to continue to look at the objects and decide where are the edges soft, where are they harder. Not every edge is hard and not every edge is soft, so you really have to do look. When something needs to be thinner, I can creep up on its edge by pushing some of the paint next to it just a little bit tighter, and I can thin out things from the outside in. A lot of times that's easier than trying to paint a thin line. Paint the line as best as you can, and then use the paint around it to make that line even thinner. Thank you. can already tell that this object's going to take more than one sitting to paint it. I'm getting to the point where I'm getting a little uncomfortable about all the paint that's here. So I think I've got it to a good stopping point. I'm going to leave this alone for now, and then when it's dry, I'll be able to add the extra highlights here, here. I'll be able to edge out those little extra darks, but I'd like to leave this alone for now. So now it's time to paint the tablecloth. As you recall, I had measured a few spots out here and I pre-mixed my colors. So the left side of the table top, the tablecloth, is going to be mostly this color, and then the front edge is going to be mostly this color, a little bit lighter. It's about one value step lighter. That's down here. And then the tablecloth gets darker back here, and I've got that color pre-mixed. Now these are just three key colors. I'm going to need some in-betweens, and I'm sure I'll have to push it a little bit lighter or a little bit darker. But this is going to give me a really good head start. As soon as you start painting in around the objects, it becomes a lot easier to see where you need to make little changes, little fixes. I can already see that there's going to be, I'm going to need a little bit of a dark edge under the bottom here. That just looks silly. I have a too light of a value. It doesn't seem grounded. It just becomes super obvious right now. Almost looks like that teacup is cut and paste there. It has a lot to do with the lack of shadowing underneath. This is one of those areas where the dark side of this form, the cast shadow, they all seem to just about merge. So I think we're going to lose some of that edge, and that's fine. If that's how it has to be, that's wonderful. I always like going up to other artists' paintings, like really skilled painters, and seeing what they get away with. I mean, some of them just seem to get away with absolutely amazing things. You never realize what they're not painting. You assume they're painting everything, but they're not. I'm not going to try to blend that. I'm going to get that step in between and just paint it in. Honestly, I think that's, I'm saying blending a lot, but I really don't think you should blend all too much. If you can physically mix the steps and then do as minimal blending as possible, I think you're going to become a much better painter. I mean, just look at this palette here. Look at how many steps I have. I premix them all, and then I'm mixing steps in between as I go. And sure, I'm doing a little bit of pushing the paint around and things like that, but you really want to try to mix as much as you can. So this painting's come a long way since I started, and there's still some steps to go through, but just about everything is painted with one layer now. And since I took my time, and since I was well versed with the drawing and the color study, what I find is that I often don't need all too much more than one layer of paint. And this is a huge, drastic contrast with how I was taught to paint and how I used to paint. I was always taught use many layers, 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 layers. And I used to not even try to get the color that accurate, and then I would just use many layers. It felt like I was making tons of progress on paintings, right? Because I'm constantly painting, right away, paint, 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 layer this, layer that. Don't even get me started on glazes. And everyone wants to glaze this, glaze that. Well, if you know how to get the right color, there's usually very little reason to glaze. The analogy I like to use, or metaphor, would be finding an address. So, finding colors in this painting is like looking for addresses in the world. So let's back it up a step. It's like finding places in the world. So I need to find colors in this painting. And if you need to find a place in the world, what most people do, to keep going with this example here, is what most painters do is they base their journey to that place off of sights that they recognize, familiar sights, familiar landmarks. And so painters will get comfortable with certain groups of colors, certain palettes, right? Everyone wants to know, what palette is this person using? What palette did that person use? Well, once you know how to measure color, that's kind of a silly discussion, because a palette is just a selection of colors, and once you know how to make colors, you can arrive at those colors in like 100 different ways. Now, there are some limitations when you're talking about extremely high chroma colors. You need to start with high chroma colors to get those, but most of real life is fairly dull. So anyway, back to the metaphor here. When you understand how to find a color, how to measure the color, that's like knowing the address of somewhere in the world. And you don't have to rely on landmarks or sightseeing or previous trips down the road. You just know an address and you go right there. And that's how I like to think about color now. I try to figure out the color. So, like an address, I try to learn the address of the location. And then I just take the shortest route to that location. So I'm going to take the shortest route to the right color. I'm not going to put a base color down and then glaze on top. And then after it's dry, scumble on top and then glaze some more. I'm just going to go right to the right color, and it's faster. So it might be a little bit slower feeling, right? You do the color study, you gotta use the aperture cards, figure out what colors are where, and it feels so slow, right? We just want to get painting already. I just want to paint. But if you slow it all down and measure it all out, paintings go faster. You waste less time in the long run. You waste less paint. And they're a lot funner too. And you know what? You learn more about color too. You don't have to rely on recipes, things somebody said, something another painting teacher told you. You can figure it out. Know your color space and learn how to navigate it. So now I've got one complete layer of paint across the canvas surface. And as you can see, the painting has made a lot of progress so far. And this is only made possible because of all of the separate phases that I forced myself to go through, worrying about one thing at a time, the drawing, the composition, the color study, and the pre-mixing. So this has allowed me to paint with greater accuracy up until this point. But I'm gonna let this dry, and then I'll get out some smaller brushes and I'll really get into some of the finer details and finish this painting. You have to be careful not to look into the shadow areas and paint your reflected lights too bright. They often look lighter than they are. You have to be careful not to overdo these little highlights, and you also have to be careful not to see them too much in the dark areas. It's very easy to want to believe that this is an equally bright highlight down here, but it's nowhere near the value brightness that's up here. These are going to be some of the brightest highlights in the painting and largest. It's a reflection of the light source. This is always a little bit of a tricky thing. You can never match this. If you measure it, it's out of gamut for any of your paints. So what a lot of artists do, a lot of times they downplay the values around it to make this seem brighter than it is. I'm just gonna keep a nice soft, really light gray around, and then I might hit that middle with something even lighter in value. Probably build up the paint slightly. So the painting is finally complete, and hopefully you enjoyed the video series. I'm going to leave a link in the description below with more information on the materials I've used and additional resources that I think you guys would like. Thanks for watching, and I will talk to you soon.